It's good to see everybody. Glad that you're all here and that you've come to be a part of our worship this morning as we are ready to make sure that we know what our responsibilities are as Christians. And you may think, well, what in the world does that mean? Well, with the national conventions of both of our parties, the Democratic and Republican parties, coming up in the near future, and I announced this Wednesday night and talked about this, that a Christian's vote matters. And as we've been going through our series on sharing the vision, one of the most important parts and aspects of that is knowing that we have in the Word of God the things that we need to know and the things that we need to do and the things that we need to understand. And one of the things that we need to know, the things that we need to understand, is that as Christians, we're given the responsibility to do God's will, and in that he tells us how we should act towards our government. A Christian vote matters. In 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 8, or how should a Christian vote? Now, some of you are scratching your head saying, he's fixing to tell us to vote for so-and-so. No, I'm not. That's not what I do. I am not a political person. I'm not very political correct a lot of times. Don't mean not to be, I just don't think about it. What I try to be is Christian. And in doing that, I have to understand that God has given us some principles of some things that we need to understand. He tells us that our votes matter. He also tells us how we should vote, and we're going to look at that this morning. In 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 8, I urged then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. This has now been witnessed to all, for all people. I'm sorry, this has now been witnessed to at the proper time. And for this purpose, I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I'm not lying, and a true and faithful teacher of the Gentiles. Therefore, I want the men everywhere to pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or disputing. A friend of mine, Jeff Stride, preacher friend, preached a sermon not too many years ago that he shared with me, and as we were discussing what it meant, I told him what I was trying to do, and he said, you might could use this, so he sent it to me, and so I want to give him credit for some of the things that he said in here, but not too much. I mean, there's nothing new under the sun, so I could have wrote this, a lot of it, you know, but he had looked this up, so I'm going to give him credit. Okay, is that all right with y'all? Okay. Every vote matters. Every vote matters. And as we look at that, we need to understand some things. There are some people that I have heard throughout my life. And I asked them, I said, did you vote? No, my vote don't matter. My vote doesn't count. They don't count my vote. My vote doesn't. There are people up in Washington and all these places that they take care of the vote, and I don't have to worry about it. I even had a person tell me one time it was unchristian to vote. I don't get it. We just read in 1 Timothy chapter 2 where God said that we need to follow the rules of the land. Rules of the land said we need to vote. We should vote. It's an honor and a privilege that we live in our country, but each vote matters. Let me tell you why. In 1645, one vote gave Oliver Cromwell control of England. One vote. In 1649, one vote caused Charles I of England to be executed. One vote. In 1776, one vote gave America the English language instead of German. Ja volt. In 1845, one vote brought Texas into the Union. Some of y'all are still regretting that. Who was that, by the way? Y'all know? No, I'm teasing. In 1868, one vote saved President Andrew Johnson from impeachment. In 1876, one vote changed France from a monarchy to a republic. In 1876, one vote gave Rutherford B. Hayes the presidency of the United States. In 1933, one vote gave Adolf Hitler leadership of the Nazi Party. In 1960, one vote changed in each precinct in Illinois would have denied John Fitzgerald Kennedy the presidency. One vote. Each votes, and each vote matters. They make a difference. It's something that we need to understand. Your vote matters. We who are Christians should honor the sacred privilege of having a choice. As citizens of the greatest nation I believe that exists and ever has existed, we should vote at every opportunity. We as Christians, I believe, need to realize that there are two inherent weaknesses in our democratic process with two problems that plague the voting public. I'm sorry, I wish it wasn't that way, but I believe that it is. The number one problem is that there are these two inherent weaknesses, but notice this, it plagues the voting public. That includes us, each and every one of us. The first problem is that we're voting for mortals. Has anybody ever voted for an immortal? And I know some of y'all thought that Roosevelt was probably going to never die, but he did. I don't care how mortal and upstanding the politician is that we're voting for and voting into office, there's one thing that is the same with him as with us. He is a human being, and human beings sin. We sin. We make mistakes. I don't care how moral you are, you're still going to be prone to the same weaknesses and sinful tendencies and temptations as the rest of the world. We know that through what we've seen over the last 30 years. These politicians are not God. They are mortal. They do not walk on water. They do not perform miracles. They will disappoint us and lie to us. They are human. Second problem, when we as Christians vote, there are times that when we cast our vote, we often do so under the mistaken belief that the candidate or the party for which we vote has the power within themselves to change the course of our city, state, or national destiny. That is not true and never has been true. Some of our best politicians have recognized this. Benjamin Franklin once addressed an assembly struggling with a decision with these words, "In this situation of this assembly, groping as it were in the dark to find political truth and scarcely able to distinguish it when it is presented to us, how has it happened that we have not hitherto once thought of humbly applying to the Father of lights to illuminate our understanding?" In other words, why aren't we praying about this? Abraham Lincoln is also quoted as saying, "It is the duty of nations as well as of men to own their own independence upon the overruling power of God and to recognize the sublime truth announced in the Holy Scriptures and proved by all history that those nations only are blessed whose God is the Lord." In 1984, Ronald Reagan declared, "Without God, there is a coarsening of the society. Without God, democracy will not and cannot long endure. If we ever forget that we are in one nation under God, we will be one nation gone under. If we ever forget," he says. I wonder where we are as a nation today. Seriously. Why would we forget that we are one nation under God? Have we forgotten? Our money, our pledge of allegiance, many of the sayings throughout the city of Washington that are displayed on the buildings all acknowledge God. Have we forgotten God? Why would we forget that we're a nation under God? How could we forget where we're going? How do we do that? Well, actually, even with that overwhelming set of witnesses, we, even as we are Christians, can literally sometimes forget the power of God over our nation. If we put more faith in our politicians than we do in our God, we are making a very deadly mistake. If we put our faith in politicians and vote for those that like our pocketbook better than others, we are destined for doom in this country. The Old Testament has an interesting story about Israel's experience with national referendum. You remember that one? The nation was uneasy. It was having trouble, it was in strife. They had a good reason to be uneasy. They had enemies threatening them on every side. The prophet of God, who was their leader at the time, Samuel, was growing old and would soon be unable to guide them as a nation. And so, and his sons, who might succeed him, were no bargains. They were corrupt, selfish boys. The people looked at the situation over and came to a conclusion that they needed a king. Why? Everybody else had one. Everybody else had a king. We need a king. We need somebody to lead us like a king. We need a king. And they wanted one. I mean, on the face of it, I mean, think about it. It made sense. Samuel was dying. The boys weren't any good. They were terrible men. If they couldn't take his place, God, you know, God hadn't risen anybody up. He hadn't raised anybody up to take his place. So let's just vote in a king. Let's find a king. Sad. They just called for a national time of coming together and voting. Let's have a king. And they wanted it now. They didn't bother to approach God and ask for his leading in the issue. They didn't call for a national day of prayer to ask God's guidance as the people of Israel. They simply held a vote and decided that that's what they needed to do. And God later told Samuel, listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they've rejected, but they have rejected me as their king over them. What was the problem? What was their problem? The problem was that they had put their faith in an earthly politician, a man. And they had taken their eyes off of God. They had made the mistake to remove their faith from God and put it into a man. Everybody else has a king. We need a king. Not everybody else were Jews. Folks, not everybody else is Christians. We need to remember that. How do we know when we've started relying more on God than on the politicians? Paul gives us a pretty good thing to think about when he writes 2 Timothy 2 and verse 8. I desire, therefore, that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. In other words, do what? Pray about it. So let me ask the question, have you ever known someone who gets so involved in politics that they get into arguments about it? To make you feel good? You like being around that kind of person? You do, as long as they agree with you. If you're in agreement, you're all right. Let's talk about this. This is great. But if you disagree, boy, get ready. I've got three sons. All three of them are different. Two are closely aligned, but yet they're different in their understanding. And then I have one son who's just completely way off. That means I have one who is very liberal, I have one that is very conservative, and I have one that's kind of middle of the road and saying, you know, we just need to be cool about this. And that's their political project. And they argue. And those of you who are friends with my children see that on Facebook. They'll all post their stuff on Facebook. I'm ready, let's go. Let's talk about this. And I set them down a couple of months ago whenever we were all together. I said, guys, you got to understand, you cannot vote according to your pocketbook. If you're voting about your wallet, you're voting for the wrong reason. If you're voting about how much it's going to cost you for this politician to be in rather than this one, then you're voting for the wrong reason. And your vote is wrong. They all three smiled at me and said, so in other words, we need to vote like Christians. I said, yeah. How hard was that? I know. But I believe that God would do it this way, one of them said. Brethren, if you find yourself getting bent out of shape because of politics, so much so that you become angry and argumentative, it's a pretty good sign that your faith is less in God and more in the politicians. Therefore, Paul tells us that there's a method that we can use to correct that situation. And he tells it in 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 and 2. I urge then, first of all, that requests and prayers and intercessions and thanksgiving be made for everyone. The kings and all those in authority, that we may live long and peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. Pray for who? Basically, he's just saying anybody in authority. You pray for them. You're under their authority, whether you like it or not, so pray for them. And no, we don't have to agree with their politics. We don't have to agree with their decisions. We don't have to agree with their opinions. But we have to honor the position. And the way that we do that is to get on our knees and pray for them. And not just arbitrarily whenever we get up and lead a public prayer. God, be with our leaders and make them believe like we do. That's what we pray. That's what we want. That's what we think whenever we're praying those prayers. We need to be saying, God, please take over and lead these men the way that you want them to go. And we're going to follow them unless it goes against your word. Amen? Isn't that what we should be doing? I think so. Gerald Flurry had written, prayer is a political action. Prayer is a social energy. Prayer is public good. Prayer shapes more of our nation's life than is formed by legislation. That we have not collapsed into anarchy is due more to prayer than to the police. Prayer is a sustained and intricate act of patriotism. In the largest sense of that word, far more precise, loving, and preserving than any patriotism served up in slogans. The single most important action contributing to whatever health and strength there is our in our land is through our prayers. You see, our deciding vote, that one vote in any election is not the one we make in the privacy of the ballot box. It's the vote we make in the privacy of our prayer closets in our hearts. The vote you make on your knees has the power no ballot box can equal. Why? The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wishes. In other words, God has the power to direct the decisions of our leaders, even the bad ones. I wrote Jeff back on that one, sent him a message, and I haven't heard back from him. I said, that one's tough. That's tough. And when we pray, we've got to believe that the power of God is being unleashed, at least in our lives. And if that's so, what should I pray about? Well, we should pray for the success of whoever is in leadership and seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive and pray to the Lord for it. Jeremiah 29:7. When Israel was held captive in a pagan nation, what did he say? Seek peace. Pray to the Lord about it, because if it prospers, you will prosper. We should pray for healing of our land. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn away from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. pray that the decisions of these leaders will lead us in such a way that we can reach more people with the message of Christ than we ever have before. That's a prayer, folks. That's a prayer of need. City officials, state officials, those within the bureaucracy and our national leaders, we need to pray for those people. So let me ask you a question. I'm sorry. Let me go back to this one. I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for who? This is everyone. So pray for everybody. For kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. Why are we doing this? So that we can lead peaceful lives, not so that we can have more in our pocketbook at the end of the week. We want God's direction more than our direction. We need to be more involved in our prayer lives. So we need to set a portion of our lives aside to pray for our leaders. Does your vote as a Christian matter? It does to God. He wants us to pray that His will be done. So let me ask you this. Have you considered this before? We should have. And we should now. And yes, I think we need to be involved in the political process. Somebody says, whoa, wait a minute. I thought you said you weren't going to tell us how to do that. I'm not. I'm going to tell you what God says. He says, pray. You want to get involved in the political process? Pray. Make good decisions. Do what God would want you to do. Vote how God would want you to vote. Spend time in prayer. We need to pray a lot about it. And so it brings me to my last thought. Your vote matters to God and to men. Are you more interested in the outcome of the vote and its effect on your bank account, or the outcome of your spiritual walk in this world? How will the vote be changed for you spiritually? How will your vote change the spiritual river of this great nation? How would those who know you best answer that question? Are you praying the way you should? Or are you more interested in the outcome of the vote and its effect on your pocketbook, your bank account, than you are on your spiritual walk in this world? How would your friends answer that question? I don't know about you, but it's time we shared the vision. Paul told Timothy, Timothy, you pray for these people. You teach others to pray for these people. It's important. It's necessary. It's something that you need to do on a regular basis. It's something that you need to do because it's right. There's many of us here who haven't voted in the past because we didn't think that we should. I'm sorry, that's not what God's word says. But before you vote, you need to pray. And before you pray about that, pray for you and ask God's guidance for you. Follow His lead. He's there. Your vote matters. As a Christian, you need to vote for God. I said that one time, and a lady said, well, God's not running. I said, no, He's in charge. He raises up leaders and He brings leaders down. But you know what? I don't think God is blind to what's going on in our world. He just wants to know how you feel about it. If you want to know how to vote, spend some time in prayer. Ask God. He'll guide you. Forget the world. Just put God first. Your vote matters. Not because of the spiritual direction somebody else may go, but the spiritual direction God wants it to go. It may be good, it may be bad. We don't know. God raises up leaders and He takes down leaders. God allows countries to rise and fall. Countries that do not put Him first usually don't last. How are we doing? Let me ask this. How are you doing? Are you ready to put God first in your life? If you're not a child of God, you need to learn what that means. And as many have done this year, we need even more to come to a knowledge of understanding. But we want to share the vision of Christ. And he says, pray for your leaders and do what is right. This morning, I hope that you're right with God. If you're not, we're going to offer this invitation. We have a song prepared. We're going to stand and sing in just a moment. And it may be that your heart has not been where it needs to be. You may not be a child of God, and we want to give you that opportunity to do that. It may be that you have sinned and done something that needs to be confessed. Whatever it is, take care of it today before you leave. Don't leave here lost. Don't leave here in question. Leave here renewed by God. And if we can help in any way, won't you come while we